So here you see that Jesus is there and Mary just comes and pours out this expensive perfume on him. The Bible says that the people were indignant, especially Judas, right? And so I want you to picture this. In comes Mary and she does this, you know, first of all, culturally at that time, that was not an acceptable thing at all. Like, hey, the guys hang out here. You guys should be in there. How did you just even break ranks and come where the guys are? Number one, you know, social etiquette was broken. Secondly, she comes and does this most unpredictable thing that no one expected. She breaks this, you know, so there's some crashing probably or some, you know, like people are just surprised. And then she's wasting this perfume. And the Bible says that this was a year's worth of wages. A year's worth of wages. Let's check about average Canadian year's wages would be what, approximately? 30, 40, 50, between 40 and 50 maybe, I don't know, depends. Think about it. If you had a perfume that was $40,000, I want that to settle in, okay? So here's someone coming in, and so it must be, you know, spikenard, it says very expensive, and it was pure. Anyway, she breaks this thing, which is 40,000 worth, and just pours it on his feet, right? And logically, if you look at it, it looks like it is a waste. And the people were actually saying, why this waste? Listen, this money could have been given to the poor. The poor, you know, like, it's a good cause. You know, Jesus encourages love and taking care of those who don't have, you know, the basic needs. And that's something that he taught and he did. And so it actually makes total sense. You know, like, why would you waste $40,000 in like an instant over, you know, someone's feet? And so they are indignant. But Jesus says something, and I want you to watch what Jesus says. Jesus said, leave her alone. She has done something what? Beautiful. Okay? So I want you to first think, my first point here is that what man may look and call as foolish or illogical or waste or indiscretion or whatever you may call it, we judge, human beings can judge from one angle, look at it from man's perspective, but God's perspective may be completely different. And I'm not talking about human perspective where, you know, like look at some things which is bad and then we call it bad. This is actually logical. I'm talking logical. Waste of $40,000 when there's hungry people, hungry children waiting to fill their bellies. So logically that makes sense. So logical human perspective, waste. Done it. They probably said she doesn't know what she's doing. She's lost it. God's perspective, he says about this, she has done a beautiful thing. Leave her, let her alone. Leave her be. She has done a beautiful thing. And so I want us to remember every time something happens and we make a judgment call on this, take a few moments to maybe ask the Holy Spirit, God, show me your perspective. Because what is ugly or wasteful to man may be beautiful to God. And in this case, it was. Even though it did not make sense logically. Isn't Jesus the one who wants us to take care of the poor? But he said, let it be. And sometimes, especially in the church, we can get really judgmental about people. Why is that person making so much noise? Why is she dressed like that? Doesn't she know this is church? Or it could be a number of other things. See, we never know what the other person says, and I'm taking the easier ones, okay? We always judge people based on their past or based on how they dress or based on what they say, or who they hang out with. By the way, you know that Jesus used to hang out with drunkards, gluttons, and you know, like these party people. Yeah, he was known for that. And it wasn't a nice, clean Holy Ghost party. They invited him and he went. And all kinds of tax collectors and Pharisees and these kind of women were there. He was accused for that. So I'm just letting you know, like some, it's very easy for us. So, you know, Matthew chapter 7 says, judge not that you will be judged. Because with the same measure that you judge, you will be judged. It's a spiritual principle. So we want to be staying, I wasn't planning to say that, but we want to stay out of judging people too quickly. Let God be the judge. Yes. Right? And then we just want to always ask for heaven's perspective. What do you think about this? Because Jesus said, hey, listen, she has done a beautiful thing. They're like, what's the matter with her? Why is she like, you know, socially indiscreet, waste? This is stupidity. And to add on to that, then she lets down her hair and then she's wiping. That's just taking it too far. Come on. But I want to say three things about this. If you look at, I believe it's verse 8, it says, Jesus says she did what she could. And I want you to remember that. See, she did what she could. Just take that phrase. He wasn't saying, you know, like, let's not worry about the. He said, listen, she did what she could. Whatever she knew, whatever she had, however she knew to offer to him to. See, you have to understand. Now, Mary's, the scenario is that Lazarus was raised from the dead. So this was the same lady who wept over her dead brother a few days ago. And then she thought God had given up on him and them. And then he shows up after 4 days and resurrects her brother. So this is a woman who not only whose sins have been forgiven, whose demons have been cast out, she's experienced a lot of love from God. And then ultimately here, her brother has been raised from the dead. I mean, literally out of the tomb, out of the graveyard. And so she has a lot to be thankful for. Maybe she just didn't think it through, you know. Or maybe she thought, okay, maybe after, you know, the ceremonial washing of feet when a guest comes into the house, she must have thought, after the washing of the feet and all is done, then maybe I will, you know, pour my perfume on his feet. And but can you imagine her shock when she's there and then they didn't wash his feet and he just walked in. He's been walking around all the streets there. And then he walks in because Jesus told Simon, you did not wash my feet when I came in, which was normal and expected. So to say the least, they were dirty feet. So maybe she just thought, oops, no towel. No, it's dirty, but that's okay. I'll pour my perfume. I'll kiss away the dirt. I'll wipe it with my feet. That's all right. Her love went beyond all those calculated things that normal. So here's the thing. She did what she could. Can you tap somebody and say, do what you can? Listen, here's the thing. When we show our love for the Lord, however we express it, we are made differently. We are wired differently. The important thing is that we do what we can. Instead of taking the backseat and judging people, let's do what we can. And here's the thing. Not only did she do what she could, she gave all that she had. That's the important thing. All that she could. And here's the thing. I was thinking, why didn't she take and just maybe drop a few drops? That's still good enough because, you know, it's an expensive perfume. She didn't come with a little sprinkler or a little spray things they would have. She gave it all. So she did what she could. And I was thinking, you know, how in the Bible, all these people, the insignificant ones, the not so famous ones, the little ones that just did what they could. For example, Moses had just a stutter and a stick. Right? But God said, what do you have? Okay, you have a stick. Okay, throw it. And he was able to use that old rickety stick. Right? And you remember the Elisha was talking to a widow whose husband was dead, and all she had was a few empty vessels and nothing else. And Elisha said, okay, let's get this going. Let's fill it up. She did what she could. The little boy that Andrew brought, the guy that gave the bread and the fish, if you look at the crowds, what's that little 2 fish and 5 loaves doing? It can't feed even 2 people. But when you give what you can, when you do what you can, God is able to multiply it. Like David, the shepherd boy. What did he have? 5 stones and a stick. And a sling. He did have a stick too. So whenever we give to the Lord, whatever we can, what did Jesus say about her? First of all, he said she's done a beautiful thing, which means I love this, right? I am pleased with this thing. Secondly, he said, wherever the gospel is preached, this will be spoken about for until eternity. And so you'll see, I don't care which church you go to, like whenever this Passion Week comes along, there's always Mary who poured the perfume. It became an eternal offering, what she did, because she did what she could. Jesus said, listen, I see her heart. She did what she could. You remember the other widow that it says when people were coming and putting their tithes in the boxes, you know, in the temple, Jesus was just sitting there and watching, like he was observing, and he saw this widow that came and put her 2 little coins. And then Jesus said, you watch her. Look, she gave the most. And they're like, what? She just gave like change. We put in the big actual paper money. And then he said, no, because she gave all that she had. I was talking to a person who's pretty rich, you know, above average, say, in the world. And then she was saying, like, well, I'm like the widow's offering, you know. I just give a little bit. I said, oh, no comparison. Because the widow gave her all. You're just giving a little, you know. Like, so yeah, it was little, but she gave her all. See, here's the point. She did what she could, but she gave her all. Right? And so God can do whatever he wants. And usually the fruit that is born out of our giving. Doing what we can. Giving it all, the fruit is always eternal fruit. It's always for eternity. So I want to ask you, you know how sometimes we want to do some stuff for the Lord. We want to do things. We are talented. We have gifts. Everybody has some gift or the other. Or we have a passion burning within us. And we have role models, you know, whether we agree or not. We have people that we look up to in whatever field it is that we feel called to or give. And then we look at, and then we feel so little and tiny. And we think like, oh, I can't. And we usually, often people don't want to start because we compare ourselves with these wonderful people. If you're called to be a musician, you might look, don't start off with comparing yourself with Beethoven. Or, if you're called to lead worship or be in the worship thing, don't start off with the biggest, most famous person here or, you know, that's available. Because that'll bring us, God's question is, are you giving what you can? Are you able to do whatever you can? Because then to him who's faithful in little, God will give much. That's just the law. And so I want to encourage you. Don't sit on what you have. Do what you can right now. Right? And do it, give it all. The third thing, and the final thing I want to say is about this lady came and she gave it her all. And if you read, Jesus said, she's doing this for my burial. I don't know if Mary had a clue about Jesus' burial, because this is a few days before he was betrayed and finally crucified and buried. I don't think so. She just did what she can out of the love in her heart. She was so grateful and she just couldn't control or restrain herself. She just had to show her affection to the Lord, and she didn't care what all those people thought. Abandoned worship. And she did it. She didn't care about the price she had to pay. She just wanted to give him her best and her all. She did it. But Jesus says, oh, don't bother her because she's done this for my burial. She's preparing me for my burial. I wonder if Mary was like, I was? Because she didn't know. But here's my third point. We need to do what we can, and we need to do it all. We need to do it now. You know why? Because Mary didn't say, well, I'll pour a little bit, and then maybe next meeting where he has in that one's place, then I'll go there and pour some more. Like, she gave it her all, but she did it. See, she had no clue that within a week, before a week is over, Jesus would be no more. See, Mary was the one of them. You remember the scene at the tomb on Resurrection Sunday? That women carried some perfume and went there. What did they go there for? To embalm the body. You know why? Because Jesus died on the cross. And then there was a rumor that he would be raised to life. So the authorities didn't want to take a chance that anyone might steal his body. And then pass the rumor that, oh, his body's missing, you know. And now he's alive. So they didn't want to take a chance. So they didn't let his body out of their sight. They took him down. And then Joseph of Arimathea, he just wrapped Jesus in the clothes and they put him in the cave, covered it up, sealed. No one had a chance to do proper burial, which was the custom of that day, to anoint them and embalm them and bury them. He didn't have that opportunity. And so Mary didn't know what she was doing. She was just following her passion and her love and her abandoned worship to Jesus. But he knew that he would not receive the proper burial. And he could see the significance, the eternal significance of the little thing that she was doing. So that's why he said, hey, you know what? Leave her out. Because he knew Mary's going to come early in the morning on Sunday to try and give him this proper burial, along with the other women. But he didn't need it, because she unknowingly had done something of eternal value. See, whenever we are motivated by pure love for the Lord, whenever we don't care about what people think, and whenever we bring that offering that's precious to him, regardless, and really being blind to, and you know, not regarding who's watching us or not, because our worship is for the audience of one. And by the way, by worship, I don't mean just what we do on Sunday morning. Worship is a lifestyle. Our offering to God is an ongoing Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and it keeps going 24/7. Our life and our lifestyle is worship. This is worship too. And so she was doing this. She was just giving him her worship. But there was an eternal significance. So here's the thing. When we take steps of faith, and when we do, when we respond to God, you know, sometimes, a lot of the times we invite people to come forward. You know, there's a word from the Lord, or there is something that the Spirit of God is doing, and we invite people. It may seem like a small thing. And we say, you know, if you relate to that, come forward. Or if you want to receive that, come forward. And it may seem like you can sit there and think, well, why is everybody going up? Like, what difference does it make? Just like, I don't know, 10 feet, you know. But you know what? God sees every step of faith that we take. It is unto the Lord. God forbid we sit on our seats and judge someone else. God forbid if we are convicted in our hearts and still sit there. She was just responding to the love that she felt. And, you know, she didn't care. She just responded to that. But God honored that with an eternal significance. That she got to be the one who embalmed him and who anointed him for his burial. Prepared him for his burial. All of heaven was watching. And then, you know, you see, it says, she wiped his feet with her hair, and then it says the entire room was filled with perfume. She anoints his head and his feet, and she wipes his feet with her hair. All of a sudden, whatever was on Jesus came on her. Come on. The fragrance that she so lavishly poured out on Jesus, all of a sudden, she was carrying that fragrance. That was not her intention. That's not where she was going. She was just serving him and worshiping him and loving him. And I'll tell you this, always, always, God is no man's debtor. When we pour out to him from our heart and when we serve him, when we worship him, when we give him, remember, like, especially worship. The Bible says that God is looking for such who will worship him in spirit and in truth. There is always a residue that happens in our life, that comes upon our life. You can tell the difference. In fact, I've thought about it often. Why would he who created heavens and the earth, he who did all these things, the miracles and reigns forevermore, why is he looking for worshipers? It's not like, doesn't he have enough? Like angels, archangels, living creatures, the whole time, 24/7, holy, holy. There's a lot happening. But he knows that worship does something to us, the worshiper. As we give out of our innermost being, we worship him. We always leave with the fragrance of Jesus. We always get of what we have offered to him. And I wonder, you know, when Jesus was hanging there on the cross with the crown of thorns on his head, when he was rejected by everyone, when the crowd said, crucify him, when Pilate gave up on him, when the nails were piercing through his hand and feet, I wonder if that aroma of that expensive perfume was still lingering somewhere. And when the blood and the sweat was dripping down, I wonder if he could smell the sweet fragrance of a selfless sacrifice and received some sort of consolation and comfort. I wonder. But can I close with this? We often think of breaking the box and you know, we understand it's symbolic of giving to God that which is most precious to us. It might have been her dowry. It might have been her social security, you know, for her old age. We don't know. It's very expensive, you know. It could have been for her future. But she gave the most expensive thing that she had. But you know what? Let's put 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7. The Bible says, and although maybe you should put 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 15 first. Let's put verse 15. The Bible says that we are the aroma of Jesus Christ to the world. And I need you to get this in your head. We are to God the pleasing aroma of Christ among those who are being saved and those who are perishing, basically, to the world. To Christians and non-Christians, we are the aroma of Christ. And the Bible says Christ in us is the hope of glory. But my favorite part is that the Bible says that we carry this treasure in jars of clay, in broken vessels, in earthen vessels. Can we go to 2 Corinthians 4, verse 7? But we carry this treasure. He was talking previous verses about the light and the knowledge of God. And he says, we carry this treasure. See, we have this treasure in jars of clay. Here are weak vessels. For a purpose that to show that this all surpassing power is from God and not from us. So here's what I want to say. As broken people, with our broken lives, with our imperfect lives, with our weaknesses, in broken vessels, we still carry the treasure. We still carry the light. We are the aroma or the fragrance of Jesus in the world. But if we keep that closed, it's not going to get anywhere. We can keep our own alabaster box shut, or we can break it. We can allow God to break it. We can use the breakings that happens in our lives to let the aroma of Christ go into the world. And so the call this morning is, would you bring that which is most expensive to you, that which is most valuable to you, that which you have paid a great price for, would you bring it as an offering to him? In true worship, But the ultimate offering we can give is our own selves, our own lives. Remember, she said, the Bible says she did it that day, but she did not knowing that she would never get an opportunity. Thank God she did it. She must have thought after Jesus died, oh, I'm so glad I had that opportunity to do it. I didn't push it for another day. And I've said this before in church, friends. The biggest deception in modern day Christianity, probably, I think, is when we put our worship, our serving God, or our following after God, when we postpone it to another day. When we fool ourselves by saying that tomorrow will be a better opportunity for me to serve the Lord. When I get fixed up all, when I get become a little better, you know, then I will serve the Lord. When I find a job, then I'm going to give. When I have a child, then I will be. When I get a car, then I'll do it. When I get, whatever it is, we always deceive ourselves if we think that tomorrow will be a better opportunity to serve the Lord. Today, now, because we don't know what next week will bring. And what we do today, as we offer, as we bring our broken boxes, as we offer the aroma to the world, it has eternal significance.